राम जय राम जय जय राम ओम श्री राम जय राम जय जय राम ओम श्री राम जय राम जय जय राम ओम श्री राम जय राम जय जय राम ओम
श्री राम जय राम जय जय राम ओम श्री राम जय राम जय जय राम ओम
श्री राम जय राम जय जय राम ओम श्री राम जय राम जय जय राम ओम
श्री राम जय राम जय जय राम ओम श्री राम जय राम जय जय राम ओम
श्री राम जय राम जय जय राम ओम श्री राम जय राम जय जय राम ओम
श्री राम जय राम जय जय राम ओम श्री राम जय राम जय जय राम ओम
श्री राम जय राम जय राम ओम
श्री राम जय राम जय राम ओम
श्री राम जय राम जय जय राम ओम
श्री राम जय राम जय राम
राम जय राम जय जय राम
राम जय जय राम ओम श्री राम जय राम जय जय राम ओम श्री राम जय राम जय जय राम ओम श्री राम जय राम जय जय राम ओम
विजय नाम सीरियस नॉट डॉक्टर
Jai Ram, Jai Ram.
exhaustively discussed about. These three gunas, how each and everything has been categorized under these gunas. When we started thinking, when we go through that, probably it may give us some academic ideas, you know, intellectual ideas, theories. So another method is, we try to see the example of others and then try to understand what is sattva, what is rajas, what is tamas. And why should we know all these things? Only when the mind is obsessed, you know, why this creation, why this variety, you know. So he says the variety, the one has appeared as many for the working out of his leela. What underlies the appearance? The quality sattva rajas tama. Otherwise the same mold will be there, you know, there won't be any differentiation. We can see the mysterious power working, you know. Same raw material, same process, but different outputs, outcome rather. Just imagine. So what can be the reason? The reason is attributed to these three gunas. As a spiritual aspirant, we also find when we go through these chapters that one has to reach sattvic, not by learning. Not by learning these slogans. But by bringing in that dimension which will make us to move towards God remembrance. This will give us some idea, no doubt. The theory is okay, but if we stop with theory, there is absolutely no use. See, when suppose you are functioning as a head of the family, you know, the father, mother, then sons, daughters, brothers, sisters, elders, relatives, so many, you know. How do I maintain the relationship? If I am harmonious with everybody, you know, just, we all know that, if I am harmonious with everybody, if I am loving everybody, I am loved. I lead a peaceful life. For everything and anything, suppose I start finding fault with them. Everywhere I see only the negative aspect. Suppose I mistrust everybody, suspect everybody. What will be the state of the family, just imagine. Everything is kept in an orderly way, not in a haphazard way. Right from the minutest to the grossest. How does it look like? We are just now trying to understand the gunas through these things, through examples. You know. That would be more better than stuffing our brain with the theories. So our own mind will interpret the meaning of sattva, rajas and tamas. We will know that. No doubt these three chapters will definitely give us some idea about it. So, from the family man, suppose I go to the field of profession. Suppose I am the employer or the employee, you know. How do I maintain as an employer? How do I maintain good relationship? How do I ensure the prosperity or success of my venture? There are two ways. One can be an artificial relationship, the other can be a very sincere relationship. Where we try to encourage the faculties lying dormant in our employees. We understand each one is capable of doing something. So we try to put them in their right place. Whenever they go wrong, whenever they right, we don't offend them, but at the same time trying to correct them with love. Suppose you are a vegetable vendor. So many customers will be coming and asking you so many things. Every customer is important for you. How do you deal with them? Suppose you are a shopkeeper. So many people come there. You may be getting a telephone, you may be some client will be asking something. Each client wants his attention to be drawn. And then how do you manage? Suppose you are a paper man. At the doctor time, everybody looks forward for the paper, especially in metros. When he comes there, suppose one day he is late, how is your attitude towards him? Your milkman? Just start thinking. We remember now Chidananda's word again, again and again and again. But daily life is an opportunity to test. So wherever we are, in whatever profession we are in whatever status we are there, wherever there is a sattvic approach, a loving approach, there we have seen it pays rich dividends. And here, you see, there is God expressing to you through that form, through that sattvic form. But you will really get the benefit only when you bring in the God dimension. Otherwise, if you limit it to a particular course of studies, you know, which is totally disconnected with the God dimension, we may be seeing a lot of people who are bringing this dimension in their life. But it will help them. It will help them at that level. Definitely it will help them. But for a higher journey, it won't help them if they don't bring in God dimension. This is what Vinobhaji said, you know. Sattva is good. Sattva is not to be eliminated, but sattva has to be wounded. Below the waist you shoot. You need him, but at the same time, he cannot overpower you. Because I may arrogate that I have, my way of handling people has brought this success. My way of handling has brought this business to a success. My way of handling has brought my family harmonious. You know, this is what I feel. At that level, he is right. He is enjoying it, no doubt. But it will not help us in our journey towards him. This is something on which everybody has to think. You may kindly go through these three chapters. Whenever you are, it will give you a lot of ideas. Because speech, action, thoughts, movements, all these things are there right from the moment we get up until we retire to bed. So all these things, even in spiritual disciplines, even in my food, even in when I feel I am doing it, understanding, so many classifications they have given in the Srimad Bhagavad Gita. We initially thought we will take up one by one. Then we felt that it will become an academic exercise, unless we bring in examples. So that we can interpret the meaning of Satrajastama in our own way, that will help us. Otherwise we may be quoting somebody, you know. And when we look at this, you know, all these examples will come to us one by one. Many years back, when my family came, that family used to, they are always, you know, they find joy in giving. So they said they would like to give rice, sugar, 1 kilo of sugar, 1 kilo of rice, 1 kilo of this, 1 kilo of that, you know, so many things. So we arranged everything with the provision wala, and we made kits. And that was, somehow people came to know, there was a big queue, very big queue. Ultimately we had to request some of our devotees and workers to discipline the queue. And this family has been giving, you know, each one is moving, giving. Somebody made a comment, people who have taken, they have sent their son or daughter or wife so that they will get one more, no? So, actually this giving may not serve. The person, you know, who organizes immediately looked at him. When you are prompted to give, give, that's all. If you allow your intellect to play all these mischief, you know, you are losing the very, very purpose for which. This had happened about 25 years ago in Nanandashram. But today when we are talking about Sattvic, you know, Papa tells, yeah, look at that. In Bhagavad Gita, it is said, anything with ostentation, anything with, you know, to make others know that I am charitable, anything that you do it with expectation, it is Rajasic, it is not Sattvic. How to understand? So here he bluntly said, if you allow the intellect to play, you are losing the joy you are getting, you know. God may test us. It is all right, after all a food article, you know. See the level. I mean, unshaken in the sattvic aspect. And that gives him joy because he is, God has prompted him. He is bringing God damage. Like that we have to connect up one by one, one by one. So that we will interpret sattva, rajas, tamas in our own way. Broad guidelines are given by Srimad Bhagavad Gita. But that will not become mine. But here it will become mine because we have observed, you know. We have observed and it stays in our heart. And at all levels we have seen this. Family level, professional level, social level, spiritual level, everywhere. The sattva, rajas, tamas, you know, playing its play. So if we can observe, you all can observe, anybody can observe. So kindly look back to your own life and pray to Papa who is seated within now, pray to God who is seated within now, to make you aware of these three dimensions and somehow to get stabilized in the sattvic for onward transmission to the ultimate. With that background, we will proceed now. We will again come back to these three. Page number 27. Question. O mother, your name is Ram. What is your form, since name and form always go together? Answer. I am without name and form. To realize me as without these, O Ramdas, you are first to assume me as having them. You must assume, first assume that I am having name and form. So even the name and form that is there is also he only, you know. And only that power which is beyond name and form can become name and form. You know? Otherwise there is only one name, you know. Only one name and one form will be there. We see before us the entire creation. So the name, entire creation is also valid. The power behind the creation is also valid. Think. Question. You are one But the universe is full of diversity. It is made up of millions of. How is this, mother? I am one, formless, nameless. I choose to be many, hence I have to assume forms without which I cannot be many. Question. You are eternal, but how is it that your forms are perishable? Answer. It is as it should be. When one is real, many must be unreal. Otherwise, why should we say unreal? So form is born, remains for a time, and then dies. Birth, change, growth, dissolution. That is the nature of forms. How can you exist, O mother, when your forms perish? Answer. Just as child, the gold remains even after the ornament is melted, during which process it loses its form. As also in the case of a lump of ice, which loses its form under heat, but the water of which it is made remains. Why did you wish to be many? You see, this is a fundamental question. That is the beauty of this. Fundamental questions. And if we don't get the answer for ourselves, there is no use of going ahead with reading. This only gives a pointer. We must get the answer for ourselves. Reading will not give the answer. Reading can help us to get an answer. That's all. Why did you wish to be many? I desire to have a play. A play cannot be unless there be more than one. Hence, I had to manifest myself as many. What do you gain by this play? Anandam, supreme bliss. Again, a wonderful question. How can you speak of bliss, O mother, when the world is seen to be full of misery? You say Anandam, Paramanandam. Dukkhalayam Ashashvatam, no? In Bhagavad Gita it says, this is Dukkhalayam and Ashashvatam. Here he says Paramanandam. It doesn't go there. Understand, my child, it is I myself acting as miserable, happy, angry, etc. How can you be acting as miserable and remain unaffected at the same time? Acting is always an appearance. It does not affect the actor. The actor pretends to be weeping, while all the time he remains internally at heart, unmoved. So also with all other feelings and emotions. What is this play of yours made up of? It is made up of three qualities, sattva, rajas and tamas. Harmony, activity, dullness. How is variety seen in this diversity? By countless modes of combination of these three qualities. These three gunas make together what is called Prakriti. O mother, are you separate from Prakriti? O child, Prakriti exists because of me, but I am not in Prakriti. Is Prakriti eternal? Individually not, collectively she is. Bear in mind always that Prakriti has only a relative existence and not absolute. I am the only absolute. If sorrow and pain are unreal, why should there be sympathy, compassion, charity, love, truth, goodness, purity and such virtues in this world? If sorrow and pain are unreal, why should there be? You see the type of questions that is. Answer. Realization of the state in which this world is witnessed as a play can be attained only by recognizing me as one appearing as many. The three gunas have to be transcended before absolute unity is realized. Now this oneness is attained only through the practice of universal love, purity, truth, compassion, charitable deeds. Question. What is this realization? This realization makes you only a blissful witness of the play of the three gunas and thus remain always free from the effects of pleasure and pain and other pairs of opposites, yourself untouched, unaffected. Then it is that you have realized the fact, you are as myself. This is how the second part comes to a close. So here also we find fundamental questions arising. So forget about the answer, because the process will take us to the ultimate. So here the process is that we must develop a keen desire, a keen aspiration to know Him. And these questions are something we are tallying with the practical life. It is very difficult to accept that it is a play. When I pinch myself, you know, it pains. I can't say it's a play. So like that, you know, if we go directly with the base ideas, then we will get the answer. So what is required is, why we are not getting these questions? Because we are not earnest, to be very frank. Earnest aspirants will definitely get these questions. That is what Papa indicates through at the feet of God. This is an indication, this is a symptom, this is the litmus test. When I don't get answers, finally I surrender to Him, no? All the answers that I get, it is on a different plane. It is not related to the relative plane. It is related to the absolute. Then only you can remain untouched, unaffected by whatever that is going on, no? So here He comes, gives us the clue. Through Sattva-Rajas-Tama in its full, what do you call, expressions, all the tendencies in our, it comes out. Inherent tendencies. It comes out in all our activities, thought, word and deed. Which is halting at every moment our realization that it is a play. But if this play is not there, how will we know that there is a stage beyond this play? Like that, you know, fundamental questions. And the answers are also, He is not referring to anything outside. We are now referring to His work, you know, outside. That is why it doesn't stay with us. The moment the session is over, the moment the utterance is over, we forget. Why, you know? It is coming from outside. Certain things we remember. Why? Because there is an alignment. There is an alignment of what is inside and what has come from outside. That is why we remember. One person was a sevak in this ashram. He was here for three or four years. He hardly opens his mouth, but always will be engaged in some activity. Throughout this 3.5 to 4 years, we have closely watched him. He has never uttered a word that will wound anybody. He has never uttered a word that is untruthful. He will never keep quiet. Suppose particular work is over. He will not sit and daydreaming, no. He will go and see who is doing what. Join with them. No words. He was very close to us. Then he has never expressed that I should become this, I should become that. But the only thing is, he has not connected up with the God dimension. That's all. And the way in which, you know, his relationship with everybody was 100% loving, cordial, because all his thoughts, words and deeds are in sattvic line only. Perfection to the maximum. Anything you have entrusted to him, perfect. Normally people who are perfect, you know, they see the rights and wrongs in others. But here I have found no rights and wrongs in others. He will not make any comment about anybody. So they teach us, but what is lacking is that they have not connected it up with the God has given you. That's probably he may be feeling, we don't know. He has not expressed. So all these values, you know, which he has now mentioned, you know, universal, what is that? Is it? Universal love, purity, truth, compassion, and charitable deeds. Three gunas have to be transcended before absolute unity is realized. Now this oneness is attained only through the practice of universal love, purity, truth, compassion, and charitable deeds. A blissful witness of the play of the three gunas. Probably. That is the tangible gain of going through this. We have seen sattvic people, we have seen rajasic people, we have seen tamasic people. Because all these things are there in us also. So that is why we are in a position to understand this is rajasic, this is tamasic. My tamas in me comes out and exhibits the tamas in others. The rajas in me comes out and exhibits the rajas in others. The sattva in me comes out and exhibits the rajas in sattva in others. Okay, that much is clear. And these three are the different play of the Almighty Lord. Okay, so I should know this. If I have to know this, I have to somehow get rid of or discipline the rajasic and tamasic and reach the sattvic and then also finally to go beyond sattvic. Now, just start seeing this. So, a harmonious relationship at home, a harmonious relationship at our professional field, a harmonious relationship with our society, all these things are excellent, no doubt. But if I have to ultimately reach the goal, I must be able to bring in the God dimension. Just like, you know, that one or two examples which we are sharing. Through that, God is teaching us, you know. So, not only that the inner dialogue comes out, but the inner dialogue comes out such points and he says, did I not throw you through that particular incident? When you started shouting to your boss, how the boss received it? Calmly, coolly. When you should not have acted the way in which you have acted to your colleague, how the colleague responded to you? Did I not teach you through him? So if we limit only with that person, no, you are so great, you are so humble, you are so sattvic, then I lose, I miss the bus. But suppose I feel God is teaching me through that particular act. When the rajas was at its top, when the tamas was at its top, through a sattvic approach, how he tamed me, then it will be helpful, because it was he who tamed me through that particular person. We don't know how far we have made it clear. So sattva rajas tama were needed. At the same time, God dimension is also equally needed. One cannot be always in sattvic state in vyavahara. So God has given us these three, but he has given us a little freedom by which we can control the tamasic and the rajasic, and somehow try to approach everything in a sattvic way, and then finally to go beyond the sattvic way to know that he is behind it. Because everything is within these three gunas. Everything. That is why in this Bhagavad Gita, elaborately he discusses. Day for yesterday we said, just like when we keep our chapel in the chapel stand, when we put our towel on the towel rod, when we put our washing clothes in the washing machine, or when we wash in the usual traditional way, how do we keep it for drying? How do we receive a visitor? How do we handle a very, somebody is upset? You also become upset, means what is the use? So like that, right from morning till evening, he puts us on various situations. There will be tamasic, there will be rajasic, there will be sattvic approaches from outside. But how do you handle it? He makes you to handle it. Suppose you also fall in, then you feel, I should have told them something. I should not have become indifferent, tamasic. I should not have become aggressive, rajasic. So in short, rajas, tamas, sattvic, sattva, rajas, tamas dominates, occupies us right from the moment we get up till we retire to bed. We have no choice. The only choice is prakritam and prayatnam. That means the only choice is we make an effort to transcend the first one, tamas and rajas, to sattvic, and finally to get over the sattvic. He says, by becoming a witness, remaining unaffected. One more sign we have observed, people who have advanced in this, even in the vyavahara, we say they are free from this wonder, vismayam. There is nothing like that. Later on, when we happen to go through Papa's words that everything is as it should be, then where is the vismayam? You behave in a particular way. Suppose I accept you as that, there is no problem with me, The problem with me is only when I expect that you should behave in this way, That means I am involving myself. The sakshi is not there. So finally he says that this realization makes you only a blissful witness of the play of the three gunas, and thus remain always free from all the effects of pressure and pain and other pairs of opposites, yourself untouched, unaffected. Then it is that you will have realized the fact you are as myself. So we have to accept the sattva rajas tamas dominance in us, we have to understand. So there should be a conscious effort on our part to remain in the sattvic mood as much as possible. How can we do that? By bringing this God dimension only. Certain people are gifted with that prakritam, as I told you, They have got that swabhava in them. It is an inherent swabhava. If they had a little more prayatna, then they will be really making use of it. In our case, probably, you know, the Rajasic may be more or Tamasic may be more. And that is our prayatnam. So I have also to do my prayatnam, my self-effort. So we try to understand from the first and second part of At the Feet of God, you know, this, what you call this, outpourings, this soliloquy, this thoughts arising from a spiritual sadhaka's mind, and he gets the answer from the source of all sources. We take it from the first and second, that's the importance of sattva rajas tamas. Here also, whether we know it or not, whether we recognize it or not, whether we study it or not, it has its play on us. So probably we can take it that by these two dialogues, we should, Papa is cautioning us, the reader, that you have not given any importance for this aspect. Please be alert and see whether your actions are sattvic. First stage. Universal love, purity, truth, compassion, charitable deeds.
Sacrifice also.
These are the words that we can add. In Hints to Aspirants, when he was making about the periodic evaluation, he has said there, no? When I know where I am, I should resort to company of saints, prayer, involving myself in acts of love and compassion. These are some of the methods. You remember the tour? When I look at myself, what am I looking for? So what are the impurities lurking in his mind, what has seized his soul, what is the obstacle that stands between him and the immortal bliss and peace, what are the bonds that keep him tied down to the low levels of life? When he has thus, by deep reflection, discovered what he is, whether it is sattva dominating, tamas dominating, then what should I do? He can, through prayer, self-discipline, company of great souls, and acts of love and compassion, get rid of all impediments, mental obsession, near darkness that envelops his soul, and realize the splendor, power, peace and joy of the great truth that dwells within him. So some clues, no? Prayer from the bottom of the heart. Knowing this, that this will be an impediment you made me to fall through. This is too much. I slipped again. I should not have done. I know that I should not have done. Why did you make me to slip again? Why did you give that particular word to my mouth? It had offended him. Like that, you know. This is called prayer. Why did you always make me to think about me? My security, my uncertainty, my anxiety, you know. Same thing is there for that other person. That is, person is behaving because of uncertainty, anxiety, insecurity in him. Why don't you make me aware? Pooja Swamiji was sharing one incident, how Mataji touched and reminded him. Somebody was there, you know, some petitioner had come and Swamiji had replied, and Mataji was observing. And then when he came, he asked, what did he say? So Swamiji said, what he did, what he spoke. So immediately Mataji says, you have solved your problem. What about her problem? From the standpoint of ashram, we would have solved it. But what about from his or her standpoint? So we are now, through our prayer, you have made us to understand all these things. That just like I have my own priorities and preferences and rights and wrongs, everyone has got equal right to have preferences, priorities and rights and wrongs. Why don't you make me to realize that before I react? I just blurted it out and then it has offended. And pernicious tendency is, when I don't like somebody, I try to dig out what all I can, one by one charge sheet, you know. Suppose I bring in the good things in them, it will get mellowed. But my rajasic activity will never permit. Because rajasic activity is such that it wants to say that everybody should accept what I say is right, you know. Because I am perfect, you know. Everybody else is unperfect or imperfect. I had shared one, you know, these are all some of the things which we learned. In a public forum, there was a debate. Somebody was telling about rights and wrongs. The person immediately could, when it has triggered controversy, you know, that person immediately got up and said, please wait, wait, wait. Everybody kept quiet. I don't think I have presented it in the way in which it should be presented. Immediately everybody stopped. Gave him a fresh sharing. That it is not artificial. I don't think I have presented the way in which it should have been presented. So the mistake is in me. That has triggered a lot of controversy. Kindly think from this angle. No. It was a wonderful thing. It was a big gathering. A lot of heated arguments were going on. But with that particular, you know, sattvic attitude from him, you could change the entire people's sattvic mood. And change it to sattvic mood. Everybody became conciliatory. Otherwise, they were all holding on to their own. So, in nutshell, rajas and tamas has to be tamed. Not tamed, you know, in Vinobhaji's language. It should be done away with. And what remains is sattva. Sattva to be wounded, but to be kept. So even in our vyavaharik, the so-called labeled vyavaharik life, family life, professional life, social life, individual life, this rajas and tamas is an hindrance. A person, no, he wants certain things to be done in this manner, you know, for the sake of for the institution. So he may leave instructions in the form of request, and then after some time when he comes, it has not been done. If he is not sattvic, he can jump at them, he can shout at them. He said, have I not told you clear cut that it should be done like this? But if the sattvic predominates, oh, you couldn't do it, no? Can you do it tomorrow? What is the problem? Any problem that I can solve? I know something must have happened. Immediately the other man, sorry, you know, I forgot the whole thing. I will do it tomorrow. I have seen this. So the sattvic approach, not only brings out perfection, efficiency, but harmony and love. And this will help us in our onward journey. So two, three things Papa is teaching us now. This world, the entire world, you know, your individual life, individual world and the total cosmic world is nothing but the expression of these three. Your job is, you should know your pragradam first, your svabhava first. So that you will be able to apply certain techniques by which, you know, by your prayatna, by which you move from rajasic and tamasic to the sattvic level. This is the first thing. Second thing is, even if you become sattvic at the vyavaharic level, unless and until you bring in that it is God's play, it will not help you in your spiritual progress. Number three, when you are doing it in love, automatically we remain unaffected. At the same time, you are not devaluing, you are not telling that it should not have happened. There is no question of it should not have happened. It has happened, that's all. So now we pray to Him, you give us that mindset. We are now convinced that one word, one slip of the tongue can do havoc. At the same time, one soothing word can be a balm, you know, a soothing balm. There are many, many incidents, you know, how a rajasic uncle, he was right, he was a righteous man, he was full of values, but he stood for certain things. And ultimately, you know, he had to become rajasic to his nephew. And after some time, you know, somehow, when he knew that this will not work, days are changing, I must change. So he immediately called and told him, you know, there is no ego there. So he called him and said, forget about what had happened, you know. From today onwards, you also handle this. How harmonious, how happy they were, no? When we hear this, how much happy we feel. Two people warring each other and then suppose they compromise and when you hear that, this is called universal love, you know. So he says here, the three gunas have to be transcended before absolute unity is realized. Now this oneness is attained only through the practice of universal love, purity, truth, compassion and charitable deeds. And this realization makes you only a blissful witness of the play of the three gunas and thus remain always free from all the effects of pleasure and pain and the pairs of opposites, the dvatita. It's a direct teaching to our workaday life. Direct teaching. Gandhiji was going with a group of people at a particular place. When they reached, it was already 2:30, 3 o'clock. Everybody was hungry. They all took their meals and they rested. After some time they knew Gandhiji was not there in his seat, taking rest. Suddenly he found, after eating, you know, all of them have thrown the banana leaves, it was served in banana leaves. And Gandhiji went there, dug a pit, was taking one by one to that place. Now see the sattvic and rajasic, tamasic. When you eat, you know, you become tamasic, you don't mean anything bad, but you just throw it. You don't mean that they should be inconvenient, that it is, you are not doing that. because of the tamasic influence. But look at Gandhiji, he did not blame, na? Somebody has to do it, that's all. So God is teaching us, hey, how can you convert? There are two ways, you know, you can also shout. You are traveling with me, what is the use? You are insensitive to these environments. They have given you food. And is this the way to behave? All those things can come. And this is not going to change them. They may feel bad, but it did not touch their heart. But the very act of sattvic touch, the sattvic attitude of Gandhiji touched the heart of everybody. Because universal love. He had love, you know, for them. He did not see it. It's all right. Children do something like that, no, unknowingly. It's all right. Somebody has to do it. That's why he started doing it. So again we repeat now that we try to understand it through examples, not through theories. Theories will help us to reproduce it in different forms. But examples, you know, will stay with us. That is the purpose for which, you know, we are made to now go through all these thoughts. It is not for getting a degree in philosophy, you know, Papa's philosophy, doctorate, no. We want certain clues from Papa's life so that we will be able to reach the ultimate in our own way. So we know some theory, but maximum experiential knowledge, not theoretical knowledge. Experiential knowledge can come only by observing it. And if we don't have to go, if we start minutely observing, we will find these three gunas explicit. How it is doing havoc, how it is doing harmony, how it is creating harmony among people. Sometime back we have shared one incident, you know, the father was to go to the office. He used to drop his child in the school. They were late or something like that. They all sat in the daughter and the father. They sat in the dining table to eat their breakfast. Suddenly the coffee or tea got spilled on his dress by the daughter. He lost his temper, he shouted. Then somehow he went inside and changed, and still the hangover was there. He asked the daughter also, if you want to come, come. And then with all this he goes to the office, suddenly he finds he has forgotten the key. He's the manager, no? Again he had to come back and went back. And the person who has narrated this has also your network connection. Suppose he had reacted as soon as the tea or coffee got spilled. Don't worry. Immediately he goes up, changes his dress, same attitude. Just say, what is it? No, unaffected. Everything goes well, you know. The child will be careful, mother will be careful. Harmony is there, nothing is lost. This is how we try to learn the graduation from tamasic and rajasic to sattvic. And then ultimately this one, you know, we have to do it because God has provided you to see, to observe. Now when it comes to you, you should not forget. We request everybody, you know, to kindly think about the examples. With that you also go through the 14, 17, 18. Elaborate theoretical approach is there for sattva rajas tamas. Elaborate. So many shlokas exclusively deal with this sattva rajas tamas. We started compiling it. It's a big list. In 14, in 17 and 18, But the claim is this. When Sattvic, Rajasic and Tamasic creates a mess of everything, Sattvic dissolves everything, paves the way for a peaceful atmosphere. And as spiritual aspirants, we will transcend that also by trying to realize that God has provided me to be in the midst of Rajasic and Tamasic, and He has somehow facilitated me to hold on to the Sattvic. And by that process, not only that you become peaceful and calmful, you radiate peace and calmness, but you also radiate peace and calmness in and around you. For that we keep our eyes open, ears open. He places before us umpty number of instances. Every month you will be getting this vision. There is a column called Dear Children. Suppose we look at it with this, you know. We are already running out of time. Anyway, one more example, then we will stop. One father and son, they were traveling. Before the son joined the father, he had a two-wheeler, and he was supposed to be in a park. So from there he was picked up. As soon as he saw his son, son was little dull, you know, little depressed. He was not in his full spirit. He did not ask anything. But father could gauge something has gone wrong. So he got into it, he went to a hotel. After finishing the food, he asked for the bill. Then along with the bill, he also put a fat sum and directly went to the cashier, no, owner seat. So he asked, why have you given so much money? Then he said, you may not remember, 25 years or 15, 20 years back, I was working here. And during my work, though you paid me salary, I was, you know, I had this weakness for my tongue. So I used to eat so many things without your knowledge. And I should have paid it, no? I did not pay. I couldn't pay also. But I was feeling guilty. Now God has placed me in a position where I can pay back. Kindly accept this. He got stunned. He said, after all, you have taken only food, you know, forget about it. He said, no, you have to accept this. Acha, okay. After that he came, got into the vehicle. Then when he was nearing the park, he asked, anything you want to do now? Then immediately, the son said, yes, he had kept the bike, he was trying to park the vehicle, motorbike. Suddenly it lost its balance. It fell on the bumper of a car. It had made a deep dent. But he saw nobody seeing it. He kept it and then joined. So he said, I have to find out now the person's car. A sattvic approach, you know. Think about it.
And also the act of father would have created more this thing.
So that is how it radiates. So now our request is we have to interpret whatever we may read from at the feet of God or from Bhagavad Gita. We have to interpret these three gunas through our own observation and experience. Then it will stay with us, it will help us in our spiritual journey. Otherwise it may purely become, no, bluntly I would say, it becomes an academic knowledge. Unless I mingle with it, no, the daily life, it will not become mine. And nobody need think that they will not have, they will have. even today, from today morning, suppose you had watched something, you would find out this. Because you are not dealing with your only, you are dealing with so many person. How was your attitude? Was it a sincere, what do you call, friendship or were sort of superficial, artificial? Hello, how are you? Thank you. All those things, you know. Do you mean when you say so? When you came out of the house or when you are moving out, something fell down immediately. Did you perfectly put it back? These are all the reminders. So now every moment we have to be alert. Sattva-rajas-tama is playing its game. So we have to be alert, alert, alert. And we may fail. So we pray to him. Why did you allow me? Knowing that it is wrong, why did you allow me? Through that person, what a beautiful play you played. And through me, you made me to slip. This is unfair. Like that, you can pray. So the take-home message can be that we should be able to interpret Sattva Rajas Tama in our own way, through our own observations. Then it comes to stay with us forever. Ever, I tell you. And every day the teaching is going on. Father life and mother...
Father life and mother nature.
Day in and day out teaches wise tuitions, That word. Day in and day out. Wise tuitions. We may not be able to grasp the whole thing, but let us have it in our mind, We would have reacted. Not in the way in which we want to react, because of our habit, we just... But immediately, I shouldn't have. Why did you make me to lose it? We try to correct ourselves. Bring him into the picture is the one strain that Papa keeps on harping. So we pay to Papa now. You are there in the form of remembrance in our heart. Kindly, immediately point out, not after that. When I am about to commit a mistake, why should you keep quiet and make me to fall? Immediately you should correct me, Papa. That much relationship we should develop with him first. If he has to respond to our call, that much close relationship we have to develop with him. If it is hello, hello, no, it won't. But it should be deep. It should be deep, intense. So let us all pray like that. So that whatever role he asks us to play at the outer and inner level, we will be doing it as a witness, unaffected, untouched by any of these things. More of it day after tomorrow. Hari Om. Om Shri Ram, Jai Ram, Jai Jai Ram Om. Shri Ram, Jai Ram, Jai Jai Ram Om. We'll be right back. राम जय राम जय जय राम ओम श्री राम जय राम जय जय राम ओम
श्री राम जय राम जय जय राम ओम श्री राम जय राम जय जय राम ओम
श्री राम जय राम जय जय राम ओम
श्री राम
श्री राम जय राम जय जय राम ओम
श्री राम जय राम जय जय राम ओम
श्री राम जय राम जय जय राम ओम
श्री राम जय
राम जय राम जय जय राम ओम श्री राम जय राम हरि ओम टू एवरीबॉडी Today, instead of taking our usual text at the feet of God, we thought it would be appropriate to remember the inspiring life and mission of Param Pujya Swami Chidananji Maharaj, whose Jayanti is celebrated in all the poverty centers today. Swami Chidananji Maharaj was the successor to Swami Chidananji Maharaj. He became the international president in 1963 after Gurudev Maharaj dropped his body. He himself says how he got in touch with Ashram. A few lines from one of his articles. You know. He was born in Mangalore. After my birth, I was expected to be brought home to my father's house. In my case, however, the maternal grandparents pleaded and prayed that being the first male child in the family, I may be allowed to remain with them in Mangalore and be brought up and educated there. Unexpectedly, almost miraculously, my father Sri Srinivas Rao understood their hearts' earnest longing and very generously granted their prayer. Thus it was that for the first 16 years of my life, I was brought up and given a good education in Mangalore town in close proximity to Kasaragod and Kanyangad, with which Ramdas's early life was closely connected. Later as a student, Papa Swami Ramdas shifted to Mangalore and did his high school at the Mission High School run by the German Basel Mission. Later, after taking a course in textile technology at Bombay and having served in a number of textile mills in different places, Papa Ramdas finally came back to Mangalore, set up a small textile business in the form of handloom factory at Falnir beyond Hampankatta. What happened to Vittal Rao, as Papa Ramdas was called in his younger days, during the period is too well known a story for me to relate anything about it. It is rendered in great detail in Papa Ramdas's well-known book, In Quest of God. This book is a narration of his wanderings all over India. Steeped in the all-absorbing power of the Divine Name, his wanderings covered the whole of the year 1923. He finally returned to Mangalore and secluded himself in some cave in the Kadri Hills on the outskirts of the town, chanting Ramnam all the time. There he was prompted to write down a brief account of his wanderings, and he did so during 1924. In Mangalore, there was a pious good gentleman called Bolar Vittal Rao. By chance, coinciding with Papa Ramdas's earlier name given to him by parents, Bolar Vittal Rao owned a printing press called Saraswati Printing Press, located at one corner of the old police maidan behind St. Paul's Church. A member of Papa Ramdas's family gave the manuscript of Inquest of God to Bolar Vittal Rao, requesting him to print it in a paperback. He printed the book, and the price was half a rupee or 8 annas. Bolar Vittal Rao and Nellike Venkat Rao, my grandfather, were very good friends. Every day after closing the press in the evening, Bolar Vittal Rao used to drop in at the Manohar Villas that where he stayed and spend half an hour chatting with grandfather over a cup of excellent coffee. Over the years, he was in the practice of bringing along with him one copy of whatever matter was printed on that day at his printing press and gave it to grandfather. In accordance with this habit, Bolar Vittal Rao brought along with him one copy of the very first 1925 of the Inquest of God. Though religious minded, grandfather was not interested in saints and spiritual teachings. Thus, the very first copy of Inquest of God was taken inside the house and deposited on the top of a chest of drawers which contained numberless novels and other storybooks of grandmother, who was a voracious reader of English fiction. I liked to read English novels of grandmother. On this occasion, as I felt to my hand on the top of the chest of drawers, it fell upon Papa Ramdas's Inquest of God, and I took it with me. Somehow the photograph of Papa, taken in front of the Kadri cave, appearing as frontispiece in Inquest of God, fascinated me and drew my gaze like a magnet. The more I looked at it, the more I wanted to go on looking at it. I did not want to put the book down. Afternoon after afternoon, lying down on a sofa in the upstairs hall, within a week, I finished reading the book cover to cover. This is the photo.
He is the first man to read it. The first man was Chidan Swami in the Inquest of God.
Maybe somebody else would be like that. At that time, I was a youngster of 9 years of age. I had just lost my mother and was staying in the fourth class in the primary school. Reading the book Inquest of God opened up before me a whole new vista of what India was, as I had never known or imagined. For the first time, I came to know the various religious places Papa had visited in his wanderings. I heard the name Himalayas and the sacred river Bhagirathi Ganga. I came to know the name of Sri Ramakrishna Paramahamsa and also the Kali temple at Bhavadharani at Dakshineshwar near Calcutta. The names Kedarnath and Badrinath became part of the thought forms of my mind where they had not existed before. The words Annakshatra, Bhiksha, Rambhajan, etc. became part of my vocabulary. The term Samadhi and Ecstasy were first encountered in my life. My new vision revealed to me the way of life people were leading in India, unknown hitherto, my limited vision, confined to home and school, and school and home. From the time I started reading the book Inquest of God, I was consumed with an overwhelming desire to meet Swami Ramdas face to face. When sadhus came to the house to ask for alms, I used to run in and fetch the book and show them the picture of Swami Ramdas and eagerly ask them, "Have you seen this person?" One sadhu who knew a little English said, "Yes, I have seen this person. He used to come to the Maidan sometimes. I have also seen him in Kadri cave, but I do not know where he is now." I was greatly disappointed. Then one day a person told me, "Oh yes, the Swami is now settled in a place called Kanjangad, close to Kasaragod. His ashram is a couple of miles from Kanjangad railway station." That is how, at last, I was able to locate where Papa Ramdas lived. I was overjoyed, and it was very close to Mangalore, and I decided to take my first chance to go to Kanjangad and have a darshan of Papa. It was 1932, and I was 16. Father demanded that both myself and my younger brother Raghavendra be shifted from Mangalore to Madras. As he said, if we continued further in Mangalore, we would gradually lose all touch with the paternal family at Madras. In Madras, as we did not know the Tamil language, we were admitted into English medium teaching section and we took Sanskrit as our vernacular second language. This is how I had the good fortune of coming into contact with the wisdom of our own country and the wise sayings of our forefathers on dharma, noble character, good conduct, righteousness, idealism in life, etc. through poetical composition called Subhashita. At about this time, my elder sister Hemalata Bai, who was given in marriage to a Sanskrit professor, lecturer in famous Annamalai University near Chidambaram, was in the family way, and I was requested to accompany her to my grandparents' house in Mangalore for her first delivery, as mother had passed away some years earlier. Some 3 or 4 months later, summons again came to me from my sister to take her and her firstborn to Coimbatore, where her in-laws lived, and then onwards to Annamalai Nagar. Obediently, I had to travel again to Mangalore. I was happy to do so. My heart was filled with a strange sensation, which I cannot describe, when the Madras-Mangalore mail passed Kanjangad railway station. I was almost tempted to make a break of journey there, but the thought that someone or other was waiting with a vehicle at Mangalore railway station obliged me to wistfully continue my journey. Reaching Mangalore, I had to wait till my sister was ready to depart with the child. At the last moment, after tickets were purchased and berths reserved, something unforeseen cropped up and we had to cancel the tickets as my sister had to sit out for her monthly period. When this happened, I suddenly realized that God had taken compassion upon me and given me a chance to make a trip to Kanjangad. Hurriedly, I packed a spare towel and pajama in a bag, handbag, told grandfather I would be away for a day, took some money from him, and boarded a train at Mangalore station going south. It reached Kanjangad sometime mid-forenoon. I got down, inquired for some people in the way to Anandashrama Swami Ramdas. They pointed out the direction of the town and told me to inquire further. Thus, being guided by people from time to time, I proceeded further in the direction of Anandashrama and soon stood at the gateway of Anandashrama. There was a long inner driveway that seemed to lead straight to the bhajan hall. When I arrived at the bhajan hall, it was midday, round about between 12 and 1 p.m., Swami Ramdas was having his midday meal, sitting in his chair with his back towards the entrance of the bhajan hall and facing towards the kitchen and dining hall at the back of the bhajan hall. He was about 3/4 through with his meal, but seeing my eagerness to see him, he made no formalities and they took me straight into his presence. At last my dream came true. My heart's longing was fulfilled. I was face to face with the writer of In Quest of God. Swami Ramdas was wreathed in smiles. His legs were stretched on a pillow kept on a small wooden stool, some distance in front of the chair. I knelt at the floor and with his permission took both the soft wheat in my hands. Bowing low, I placed my head beneath his feet and gently pressed his feet on top of my head as though in benediction. Only it was Ashirwad or blessing with his divine lotus feet instead of with his hand. Thus I experienced heaven upon earth with his first darshan of Papa in this wonderful center of Ramnam Anandashram. It was an unforgettable experience. Even to this day, it is fresh in my memory. Afterwards, conversation took place between us. I asked him a number of my questions. Some of them he answered, others he countered by asking some questions himself. After some time, he inquired whether I had taken my food. When he heard that I had come straight without taking anything, Swami Radhanath was kindly asked them to take me to the kitchen and serve me my meal. Looking back, I think it was Puja Mataji Krishna Bhai who served me my meal that day. I remember how she was all kindness and loving concern, lest due to my shyness, I may not eat sufficiently, being a newcomer on my visit to the ashram. I ate and rested a while. They pressed me to stay for the night, but I declined and told them that after Papa's rest, I would take leave of him and return to Mangalore the same evening. They took me to the mission office and I purchased a new copy of Inquest of God. Then taking leave of Swami Ramdas, I came back to Kanyangat railway station and boarded a local train, reaching Mangalore in the evening. During these days, 1930s, one well-known and popular publisher and writer called M.S. Kamath used to publish a weekly newspaper called Sunday Times from Madras. It was very popular and liked by the public because of the variety of features it contained. There was always at least one page exclusively set apart for religious subjects. On Sunday, I was pleasantly surprised to see Swami Ramdas's picture on the religious page, and I was excited to read also an announcement that the Swami would be visiting Madras at the invitation of the Saraswat community of the city and give a few discourses while there. It gave the program with the date and time of the meeting. One day it was a discourse at a well-known venue called Gokhale Hall in the evening hour. On another day it was an informal and midday satsang talk with Ram Bhajan and Darshan as well as meals that followed. Before leaving, I inquired about details of how to reach the Gokhale Hall because our family lived far away from the busy part of the city, with our house located at the very outskirts of Madras, just before where the municipal corporation limits ended and district board area commenced. When I reached Gokhale Hall, I found it completely packed to capacity. I could not even enter the hall. Very many persons were standing at the back, as all seats had been filled. As it had taken some time for me to locate the hall, Papa Ramdas was already speaking when I reached there. My eyes beheld a strange sight. The usual formal seating arrangement on the dais with a table in front and a few chairs behind did not seem to have met with his approval, and he had the chairs pushed back to the wall and the table moved forward until it was almost at the edge of the dais. He was seated on the table in his usual pose with legs folded, body absolutely straight, hands moving with appropriate gestures in keeping with what he was saying. He was speaking in Konkani. Words poured out of him in a ceaseless torrent. He was in an inspired mood. He was speaking about the glory of Ramnam and the need to lead a disciplined life. The audience was listening spellbound, taking in everything he was saying without missing a word. Before I left, I inquired from the organizing person where Papa was staying in Madras. I was told he was staying in the house of one Dr. Gopal Katre in a well-known locality called Santom, which was the southernmost end of the famous seaside marina of Madras, where the clear open beach road ended and residential locality started. The next day, eager to have darshan and satsang with the holy saint, I went all the way from Chetpe to Mailapur, where the bus terminated. When I had to walk further eastwards toward the seashore to reach Santom. Santom Road was also a long stretch of a road parallel to the sea with a few residential buildings on either side. When I went past the Mailapur locality and came to Santom Road, I asked a couple of persons where Dr. Katre lived. They did not seem to be certain, gave me some vague reply. Actually, from the spot where I questioned, Dr. Katre's house was merely within a furlong's distance to my left side, but somehow due to unfamiliarity, I turned right and started walking, stopping now and then to ask local persons where Katre lived. I must have walked more than a mile in the hot sun. Then I halted and asked another person, "Oh, Katre, you mean where the holy man Swami Ramdas is staying?" I said, "Yes," nodding my head vigorously. He told me that I had travelled in the opposite direction and was going farther and farther away. And with each step I took, he said I would have to go all the way back. even past the turning into Mailapur and would find a double-storied house standing in its own garden to the back of the road to my right hand. Thanking him, I walked all the way back. It was hot. I was perspiring. It was now about mid-afternoon. At last, I located Khatre's house, went into the house, climbed upstairs. I was told that Swami Ramdas was about to leave for some engagement, that I had better hurry up and take my chance of not missing him. I ran up the stairs, came to the second floor room. Sure enough, Swami Ramdas had put on his sandals and taking his walking stick in his hand was coming towards the staircase to step down. Someone took me forward and told Swami Ramdas Maharaj, "This young man has come to see Your Holiness and get blessings." I immediately knelt down, touching his feet with my forehead. Swami Ramdas bent down, resting one hand on his walking stick, gave me a strong and hearty pat with the other on my back. He said, "Ramdas's blessings are always there. Ramdas has to leave now. Take Ramnam, remember God," and he went down to the waiting car. Such was my brief encounter and second darshan after my darshan and meeting at Anandashram. 2 years later, the World War, So this is how he met. We can see from this, you know, the way in which he explains everything. Nothing is irrelevant, nothing is unimportant, nothing is insignificant. When he starts writing it, when he starts delivering anything, all the minutest details will be covered. Actually, if we religiously follow his teachings, he will somehow ensure that we don't have any doubts about the facts discussed. Swamiji is a unique person, meticulous and minute in everything. Even if he goes to the bathroom, he will not straight away use it. He will first clean everything. There is a rhythm in Swamiji's doing everything. Very simple and humble, but at the same time, the moment we come in contact with him, he will straight away enter into our heart. We were all blessed to have his darshan, especially before coming to ashram and after coming to ashram, probably on a regular basis, from 89-90 onwards till almost 2001 or 2. It was Mataji's adesh that he should spend 10 to 15 days in the ashram without any program. And every year he used to come. And it was an utsav here when he comes here. It is not merely because of the sentiments, you know, not because of our attraction towards his form. Because of his simple way and absolutely non-traditional. When he arrives at the ashram, suppose he is coming by the car and suppose the car takes him to the bhajan hall, we will all be waiting there, you know, with Puja Swamiji. He has got a knack of making everybody blind and somehow he gets out. Nobody knows how he gets out. And next time when we see, he will be touching Swami Sachidananda's feet there. Many of you might have heard this from us. Anyhow, it is worth repeating when we share this thought. Our first meeting with Swamiji Maharaj. It must have been in 1963, immediately after he took over as the president of the DLS. DLS had arranged a reception at Chennai in Venus Colony in what is the place called? We forgot. And so elaborate arrangements were made, the big pandal was put up, a big crowd was waiting for him. All the reception committee members, everybody, you know, we were all waiting for him at a particular place with all the, you know, protocols, you know. Every time when a car comes, we look at it, it is not Swamiji. He was coming straight from the Venambakam airport. As we were just thinking, you know, he is a very gives a lot of importance of punctuality. Suddenly, somebody said, a lean person is running toward the dais. And when everybody turned, you know, they said, that is Swami Chidanji Maharaj. We are standing here to receive him. He is already in the dais. And his dress, one small upper cloth on this side, and something like a towel, you know, which covers only up to his knee. That was his dress. Anyway, everybody got stunned. And the pace with which he walks, you know, nobody can keep up. And he started, you know, straight away going and took the mic and facing the big crowd. Nobody, you know, everybody was in attention now. They did not know what to do. All the so-called reception protocol, all those things are there. And that, you know, that voice is still ringing in our ears. Radiant Atman. Blessed and beloved children of God. This radiant Atman is something, you know, it is so dear to his heart. Radiant Atman, blessed and beloved children of God. And he gave his Ashtanga pranams to the entire audience. So when he was addressing as radiant Atman, he was feeling it. You know. There is an article by him, why we are called radiant Atman. And then of course everybody went there. Swamiji continued his talk. Later on only all those, that's why we said, you know, he doesn't stand on any formalities. He is one with everybody, you know. Very striking. Nobody, even when he comes here to ashram, at the time of leaving, suppose he is leaving by train, we all used to go up to the station. No. When we go to the station, not like this, now station is at least without comforts are there, seats are there. There will be some cement bench open, no? Open. He will go and sit there. And some chocolate or something will be there that he will take. He will call everybody who is going this side and that side and give them and chat with them. Where are you going? How are you? Nobody is a stranger to him. Nobody is unimportant to him. Nobody is irrelevant to him. Many, many, many things he teaches us by his very presence. And when he talks, it will be simple words, not tall talks, but profound. We will read a couple of articles, messages he delivered. On Vijayadashmi day, he had delivered this, you know. Ask what I am living for. You know, fundamental questions, you know. May the abundant divine grace of the Supreme Almighty Being shower upon you now that you have entered into a new phase after the 9 days of worship of the Divine Mother and the celebration of the victory of light over darkness of the divine over the undivine. Here we would like to also mention the uniqueness. He gives importance to everything. Suppose we talk about puja, he knows everything about puja. We talk about bhajan, he knows everything about bhajan. And he himself will lead the bhajan. Suppose you talk about yoga, he himself will show you all the yogic exercises. Even at that age, when he comes here, everything, you know, like a child, he will master it. anything. Suppose also, even during here, suppose it is a Skanda Shashti or anything connected with the deity's important day. On that day, satsang, you will make a mention about it. So personal as well as impersonal. That is why the Navaratri Puja day, when he says this, so that means, you know, we take it that everything is relevant. There are two, what we infer from our close observation of him is, it is up to us to take the God dimension from anything and everything. We need not discard, we need not over-associate, no. Because everything is His. So on the ninth day, when he was addressing, he says, you know, that much importance is given. May the abundant divine grace of the Almighty, Almighty being shower upon you, now that you have entered into a new phase after the 9 days of worship of the Divine Mother and the celebration of the victory of light over darkness, of the divine over the undivine. Durga Puja, no? Vijayadashmi. There should be the urge in you, no? Somehow, how does he connect, you know? We are all, you know, when we associate with puja, we associate with the outer things, you know? The outer activities, outer preparations. Everything that is outer, 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 we give a lot of importance. He, while giving importance to the outer, he also equally gives importance for the symbolic significance behind it. That is the advantage. He says, there should be an urge for you for self-improvement. There should be the urge for evolution in each one of you. The hallmark of an awakened and enlightened individual human soul is that there is a recognition that life is not meant for stagnation and that it is not meant for routine, humdrum, repetition of the same monotonous activities. But it is meant for achievement, for attainment, and it is meant for moving towards a supreme goal, a lofty, sublime goal. It is meant for living for a noble ideal. Life is an ascent, an upward ascent. Those who have bestowed thought on life soon begin to realize that life is not merely a biological function. It is not merely a psychological activity, a confusion of restless psychological activity. Rather, it's a higher and spiritual movement. It is a higher and spiritual evolution. Once that is known, one has to constantly ask, am I engaged in this upward movement of the spirit towards regaining a state of perfection that is its natural state, natural condition? It is therefore good to ask, what am I living for? With what objective? To what end? For that, what purpose? You know, fundamental questions. You know. So that gradually such repeated questioning begins to make your goal, make your objective clear-cut. In the course of time, slowly but steadily, you become established in a firm conviction. This is what I am living for. No, I get clarity. This is what I am striving to attain and achieve. Life is meant for God realization. The goal of life is God realization. This is very easy to say, and that may be your ultimate goal, but you have to live here. Very much in this world, amongst people and things, undergoing various experiences with the different events occurring too. So in this environmental setup, in this atmosphere, involved in the ever-changing process day after day, how are you to live your life? What is your objective here? First of all, let us decide upon the immediate dimension that we know, which we have to enter into, encounter, and be a part of day after day. First of all, solve this. Later on, you can think about big things, which are more concepts than the clearly seen and recognized situation that is unfolding before you every sunrise. Every time you wake up in the morning, you have to deal with something. First of all, be sure of how you are to live that, to what end, with what objective. What is the purposefulness that should propel you forward in meeting the world, in living day after day? What is the objective? How should one live here? Later on, we can think of Brahmajnana or liberation or God realization, all those things. A great deal of study is necessary before that concept is clear. A great deal of reflection and deep thinking is necessary before the concept can be clear-cut, properly grasped, fully understood. But here is immediacy. And unless this is well understood, properly seen in the right perspective, and a very clear way of living this life is formulated, we shall ever be floundering here and our legs will be entangled. One won't be able to move forward. Therefore, first things first, that which is immediate should first be clarified, well understood, definitely decided. It is in this context that our culture and our masters have given much insight, a great deal of distance. Gurudev said, speak little, speak softly, speak sweetly. Day after day, as you enter into Vyavahara, be a person who speaks softly, who speaks sweetly. Gurudev said, be kind, be compassionate. Let kindness be your motto. Be a person who is compassionate. A compassionate person does not sit in immediate judgment. A compassionate person is charitable. He tries to tolerate. He tries to understand with sympathy. He does not immediately give verdicts, label things and persons. He tries to understand. He tries to argue in favor of the underdog. Perhaps this person has some problem, he will always say. So a compassionate person is also charitable, loving. He tries to understand, to forgive and to forget. Therefore, Gurudev has given us objectives to live away. Day after day as we move through life, progressively, in increasing measure, we should become a kind and compassionate person. A doer of good. Saint Francis of Assisi has also given us a grand formula, a great concept. O Lord, grant that I may not so much seek to be consoled as to console, to be understood as to understand, to be loved as to love. For it is in giving that we receive. This is life sublime. Not wanting to receive, 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 but wanting to give, give and give. If we begin to gather these lofty insights from the great ones, who have not shown us the path through their words, but by their own personal example, and begin to apply them, to live in their light, then suddenly a day will come when we begin to realize that the serious business of life is to train ourselves, educate ourselves, cultivate ourselves, develop ourselves, and polish ourselves. This is another uniqueness of Swamiji. He will not be satisfied with one adjective. To get it concretized in our mind, he will repeat it through different words. Same words we use, we say monotony, you know. Different words. So if we begin to gather these lofty insights from the great ones, not through their words, but their personal example, and begin to apply them, to live in their light, then suddenly a day will come when we begin to realize that the serious business of life is to train ourselves, educate ourselves, cultivate ourselves, develop ourselves, and polish ourselves, so that we become an ideal human individual. We become a source of good and of benefit to others. We become kind, compassionate, understanding, tolerant, helpful. This indeed is the objective with which we should live. This indeed is the goal we must try to achieve. So at the vyavaharik level, no? We are not bringing any tall words. He is bringing how I should react to events and individuals, what should be my mindset. At home, in the office, with the society. Be like salt. Without salt, everything will be insipid. Nothing will be tasty. The great teacher of the Middle East, Jesus, told his followers, you are the salt of the earth. But if salt has lost its taste, it is no longer good for anything except to be thrown out. Therefore, we should be ever occupied in trying to make ourselves into such an element, such a factor, that it makes life livable for others. It helps make life worth living for others. This then is the objective. We were remembering one poem which we learnt in school, no? Parathamakuga pagalim ravum prabhu namaskaram. Day and night make my life useful to others. Parathamakuga pagalim ravum prabhu namaskaram. This is the foundation, no? Selflessness. All that he said about compassion, love, goodness, you know, it all zeroes to this. Make me a useful instrument. So that's what he says, you know, we should be ever occupied in trying to make ourselves into such an element, such a factor, that it makes life livable for others. It helps make life worth living for others. This then is the objective. To live in such a way, that day by, sorry, to live in such a way that day by day we become a better and better person, more and more an ideal human individual, so that life is better off for our being in it. Not a killjoy, but a joy. Not an element of disharmony or discord, but an element of harmony, concord, sweetness. The whole world wants sugar because whatever it goes into becomes sweet. When the sugar is applied to anything, you know, it becomes sweet. The whole world wants salt because whatever it goes into becomes tasty. We should think of ourselves and our personality in this light. Bah. Let us become like salt and sugar. We are not yet that. But we should work for that. This is the great adventure. This is the great privilege. This is the great serious business of life, to work upon ourselves and make ourselves a center of fragrance. To make ourselves, in the wise words of the poet, a thing of beauty and a joy forever. Make this your objective. Try to achieve this. Move toward this great attainment. Then life has been well lived. You will not have lived in vain. Rather than thinking that others should behave towards me in this way, others should speak to me in this way, others should do such things for me, first let me be this way to others. Let me speak to others in this way. Whatever I want that others should be towards me, let me first of all start the process of myself so that it stimulates a similar one in others. Let me be the initiator of such a process in a social milieu through which I have to move as I progress towards the goal. This, therefore, is the great opportunity that faces each one each day. This, therefore, is the deeply interesting experiment, deeply interesting task that you have to perform with great perception, with great delicacy, great sincerity, great earnestness, with great enthusiasm and a positive, creative, constructive, determined heart. Papa. God has given me the material. May I work upon this material and make it a thing of beauty, a joy forever. May I work upon this material so that day by day it becomes more and more perfect, more and more complete, more and more what God has in mind for me as my plan and purpose. This is life. Working upon ourselves day by day, moving towards a state of perfection. You have brought everything to this in a word, no? Perfection. Day by day. What am I living for? Ask yourself. To make myself into a thing of beauty, a joy forever, a perfect specimen of my species. Pop. This is what I am living for. This is the objective. Now everything is clear. You have an objective, you have a clear understanding of what you are meant to do. Do it. God bless you. Gurudev has already helped you. His wisdom teachings, casting such a great light upon life's path, are your ready-made help. Only you must recognize the message. You must accept and absorb the message. Everything is clear. There is no ambiguity. There is no confusion. There is no vagueness. There is no doubt. This clarity comes if you ponder life, deeply think, wisely observe yourself, observe life, observe the saints, how they live their life. Observe good people of God. Here then we stand upon the threshold of a new beginning, on the day following the glorious day of Vijaya, a victory, and as we move towards the festival of lamps, where darkness has no place, where everything is filled with brightness. This is one of his sample, you know, addresses. Invigorating, you know, electrifying. It will shake us. Ask what I am living for. No? When we keep on pondering through the words of our spiritual preceptors, the clarity comes to us one by one, one by one, one by one. In another very, as a sadhaka, you know, we would have repeated this many a time, but still, it is worth repeating 1,000 times. Are you becoming a better person? Spiritual perfection and divine perfection follow ethical perfection. I am sitting in a room and performing all my spiritual activities. No. Ethics comes only when I deal with others, you know. That is called ethics. The ethical, moral ethical values, you know. So when I deal with others, so that means all my spiritual discipline should be reflected in there, in the way in which I react to events and individuals. Swamiji starts this message with that. Spiritual perfection and divine perfection follow ethical perfection. Where there is dharma, there is adhyatma. Where there is no true adhyatma, there is bound to be. Where there is true adhyatma, there is bound to be true dharma. If there is adhyatma and true dharma is lacking, then the adhyatma is imperfect. It is not complete. These truths must be very clearly understood and grasped. They should be made the basis of our spiritual life. Dharma is the foundation. Sadhana is the structure. Adhyatma is the completion. Even if the structure is all complete, but no roof has been put on it, no one can live in it. Adhyatma, therefore, is that which completes. But both the structure of the sadhana as well as the completing roof of adhyatma can only be raised upon the foundation of dharma. God alone is perfect, eternally perfect. No one is perfect in the created phenomenal world. But all have the potential for perfection. And life is a means, a chance for rising beyond imperfection. Of shedding one's imperfection and gradually making the incomplete complete, of rising into a state of perfection. That is why life has been given. And sadhana is the method, it is the technique. Sadhana is the scientific system of attaining the perfection. This article, for sadhakas like us, you know, every day we must go through the contents, you know, we may not be able to remember all words. But the theme, you know, the decoction, the essence. An unripe fruit in a garden is imperfect. It is neither sweet nor satisfying. It is hard and sour and maybe bitter also. One cannot enjoy it because it is imperfect. An unripe fruit has to utilize all nature around in it in order to gradually rise above its state of imperfection and become a perfect, delicious, juicy, sweet, tasty, ripe fruit, which gives satisfaction and nourishment, which gives great joy to one and all, birds, bees, as well as man. See the adjective? Perfect, delicious, juicy, sweet, tasty, ripe fruit. So the whole process is a gradual transformation from imperfection to perfection, from incompleteness to completeness, from a defective human nature into a beautiful, all-perfect divine nature. And the potential for this transformation is within each human individual. God dwells in all beings. But all beings cannot become aware of His indwelling divinity. It is only given to man who can think, again, no? Who can think, reason, reflect, introspect, read, listen, understand, gain knowledge. You have forgotten all the one, no? Take one, no? It is only given to man who can think, reason, reflect, introspect, read, listen, understand, gain knowledge, expand his understanding of himself. To this unique being alone is open the ability, the scope, the possibility of recognizing this mission and engaging in purposeful, meaningful endeavor and thus become perfect. Therefore, now you know, all these are okay. Now he takes us to a very, very serious stage. Therefore, one of the unfailing touchstones and one of the necessary tests of a truly spiritual life and a rightly oriented sadhana is, what is my sadhana doing to me? What is my spiritual life doing to me? Quite apart from its connection with God or our eternal reality, the spiritual life and sadhana have also to be tested upon the basis and factor of your relationship to God's creation. Apart from my connection, you know, my inner dialogue with God, my Ram Nam chanting, so many things, you know, we have a concept about sadhana, of tying ourselves, linking ourselves with the Almighty Lord. But here, he says, as soon as that you are back again, in the midst of God's creation, you are trying to understand that all these things are God's creation, no? Our sadhana now, inwardly, implicitly he puts it, that our sadhana is to know that everything is God's creation. So we should know about God. And once we know about God, what will be our relationship with God? Not a God in a room, in a cave, in a temple, in an ashram, but with God's creation everywhere. So he says, what is my sadhana doing to me? What is my spiritual life doing to me? Quite apart from its connection with God or our eternal reality, spiritual life and sadhana have also to be tested upon the basis and factor of your relationship to God's creation. As you are proceeding in your spiritual life, are you becoming a more and more compassionate person towards God's creatures? Number one. Are you becoming a more and more truthful person in your dealing with other persons? Are you becoming more and more a person of sublime, noble and pure thoughts, sentiments, motivations and actions? Is this taking place? Is the unripeness of an imperfect human being, human nature, gradually giving place to a maturity, to a ripeness of spiritual nature? Is it ultimately moving towards a perfection, a divine perfection in a divine manner? Day by day, one should test oneself upon this touchstone. What is my sadhana and my spiritual life doing to me? What process is taking place within me, within my mind, within my heart, within my gaze, within my attitude, within my approach to life, within the inner hidden motive behind my activity, which only God, the indwelling reality, knows, and I know perhaps. I know perhaps. This is the touchstone. Are you becoming a better neighbor to your neighbor? Are you becoming a better disciple to your guru? A better fellow seeker to other fellow seekers? In ashram, you know, we have to. Are you becoming a positive, creative factor of inspiration and adoration in your contemporary human society? What is happening to you? It is very, very important that you keep a tab on what is happening to you. What are you becoming? Because they say that sadhana is a sort of alchemy, a process of alchemy. Alchemy is that hidden mysterious science by which base metal is turned into gold, the royal material. And that alchemy must take place within your personality, within your thought, within your feeling, within your objectives, within your motivations, within your conduct and character. Any real authentic sadhana and spiritual life, any genuine yoga, must inevitably, invariably bring about this inner transformation. An orchard is valuable because fruits ripen. If there were only green and sour fruit, no one would go near it. In the garden of spiritual living, this inner process of becoming ripe or becoming mature must invariably follow all sadhana that is rightly engaged in, all sadhana that is correctly oriented, all sadhana that is being done with an in-depth understanding of what it is supposed to do to one's life, to one's nature and personality. Therefore, this touchstone is a method of testing yourself, of ascertaining the nature of your sadhana, whether it is going upon correct lines, whether it is being done with understanding, whether it is bringing about an inner transformation. This here and now inner transformation is as equally important as the ultimate Brahmajnana. I want to say this is even more important. Inner transformation. It is a precursor to that. If it is taking place, it will ultimately lead you to Brahmajnana, to total perfection in God experience. If it is not taking place, you will have to wait long, because there is something blocking the needed inner transformation. Sadhana makes a person good person. Sadhana makes a person a truthful, tolerant, compassionate person. Sadhana creates a person of noble character, pure conduct, holy life, of sanctity in all one's activities, thus it becomes the gradual process of the ascent of the spirit towards God consciousness. Imperfection is not to be kept forever. Though we may be born imperfect, it is not to be tolerated, not to be maintained, it is to be got rid of, transcended, to be made to give place to perfection. That is life, that is the meaning of life, the value of life. Therefore, with this goal in view, one should work upon oneself at all levels, becoming better and better day by day, until one day becomes godly, divine, full, totally perfect. This indeed is each one's responsibility, each one's mission in life, each one's great duty. So like that, Swamiji is there is one more time, he is running out. Tomorrow we will take up that also. Because he says, you know, daily life and daily sadhana. Daily life and daily sadhana. He says, daily life is an opportunity provided for us to exercise the spiritual dimension gained during our inner studies, reflection, japa, meditation. It is the testing ground. What is the testing ground? Daily life. When I deal with men and matters at the household, when I deal with the men and matters at the family level, professional level, social level, this is the testing ground. Not that, you know, you go before a guru and ask him, how have I progressed? No. Testing ground is there before us. God has provided right in front of us. And he says, it's a testing ground so that each day our progress is really ours. by going through a lecture on driving, by going through a lecture on dwelling on manana, doing manana on swimming, by going through a lecture on grammar, we are not going to master it. Cycling, cooking, everything, you know, walking. Think about, go back to your own life. Everything we have learned only because there is a field there. We have tested it every day, improved it from imperfection to perfection. When you write first letter, you know, when you correspond and then you start, may make a lot of mistakes. But unless the field is given, how will I make it perfect? Everything has come only because of that. So Swamiji is directly going to that. We have got a different picture now. Daily life is an opportunity given to us. Now he will say that. Daily life is an opportunity provided for us to exercise the spiritual dimensions gained. We may be doing Ramna, we may be doing Bhajan, we may be doing, you know, Swadhyay. We can quote. But as an individual, when I deal with men and matters, how does it get reflected? And then only he says it becomes ours. Otherwise it is a bookish knowledge, you know. Intellectual knowledge. Textual knowledge. It cannot serve beyond that telling or reproducing, memorizing. It's a testing ground so that each day our progress is really ours. We have made it our own by having tested it, proven it, possessed it. Until it has been tested and proven, it is not our own. It does not become part of us. So that is why, you know, during the non-chanting time, what we do matters much while taking to chanting. If there is a constant, what you call, urge in us to expand, and it is for that purpose I am chanting the name of one who is there in everybody. Expansion means from the limited to the unlimited. So I am chanting the name of one who is there in everybody. So this expansiveness will straight away come to me when I chant with that perspective. Otherwise chanting goes on as a discipline. I can give a count. But expansiveness, you know, have I become, am I moving toward that expansion? That only my daily life can ensure is. So he says, so this is how, yeah, this is how Pooja Swamiji points out the importance of blending the labeled spiritual life and the labeled worldly life. In the first article he on the Vijayadashmi day, you know, he said that, you know. And the second article confirms it. So on this day of his Jayanti, he was born this day in the year 1916. And he attained Mahasamadhi in the year 2008. 1 month before our Pooja Swamiji dropped. Swamiji was very close to ashram, Swamiji was very close to Papa Mataji, Swamiji. Anandashram means, you know, still the feeling is there. But we were attracted, not because when we started seeing him in the ashram, but we got attracted because he is in a position to see both with equal importance. Just like Papa's philosophy or Gandhiji's philosophy, we should become, in one of the articles he says, as we progress in the spiritual path, we should progress more and more on the human plane. Because as soon as we are free from the spiritual disciplines, we are one with the society, you know, one with our family, one with our professional field. how do we behave there? So, in so many words, Swamiji wants us to demolish the barrier between, the divide between spiritual and worldly. Both should go hand in hand, nothing at the cost of another. One is the theoretical background, ideological background, the other one is the practical background. If both go together, we are on the road to perfection, we are on the road to completeness. So with a heart full of gratitude and reverence, we mentally prostrate before Swamiji Maharaj and seek his blessings so that our move towards the ultimate becomes faster and it becomes a reality in our life soon. Hari Om Tatsat. Om Shri Ram Jai Ram Jai Jai Ram Om Shri Ram Jai Ram Jai Jai Ram Om
Shri Ram Jai Ram Jai Jai Ram Om Shri Ram
Shri Ram Jai Ram Jai Jai Ram Om Shri Ram Jai Ram Jai Jai Ram Om
Ghan Shyam Kaam Anek Char Loka Viram Manogar Kinjal वासन किशोर मूर्ति भूरी गुण करुणा किंजल वासन किशोर मूर्ति भूरी गुण करुणा गोपाल गोकुल वर प्रिय गोप गोसुत
Ram Jai Ram Jai Jai Ram Om Shri Ram Jai Ram Jai Jai Ram Om
Shri Ram Jai Ram Jai Jai Ram Om
Shri Ram Jai
Ram Jai Ram Jai Jai Ram Om
Shri Ram Jai Ram Jai Jai Ram Om
Shri Ram Jai Ram Jai Jai Ram Shri Ram, Jai Ram, Jai Jai Ram. Hari Om to everybody. At the feet of God, again and again we are prompted to repeat this. This is not a question answer session of that is taking place between A and B. It is purely a dialogue that takes place within us, the sense of individuality or the thought raises some certain fundamental doubts, and the witness consciousness, the support, the Lord, the Spirit answers it. So while hearing this should be borne in mind. When are you going to give me such experience? Otherwise, you know, it is a dialogue, we will hear a question and answer. So the main purpose of probably bringing this in the mind of Papa was that everyone should develop this attitude of talking to the indwelling spirit. And what should be talked? It depends upon the intensity of our aspiration. Because then so many hurdles are crop up, and then the hurdles are placed before the indwelling reality. So it is purely a dialogue between the sense of individuality with the indwelling reality. Because many of us would not have thought about these questions also. So probably Papa thought these are, when you read this, when you develop this, when you pray for this attitude, something else will turn up. What is actually needed for us to give us a push in our spiritual journey, that we will ask. Anyway, having printed this, we are just going through it. It will help us intellectually, no doubt about it. But far more than the dialogue, the attitude that is developed, that is to be developed, is more important. Because it is not a dialogue between A and B. It's absolutely and purely, 100%, is an inner dialogue that is taking place. Anyway, we will read. Page number 27. Question. O Mother, your name is Ram. What is your form, since name and form always go together? Answer. I am without name and form. To realize me as without these, O Ramdas, you have to first assume me as having them. Without name and form, it is difficult. So, he is also with name and form, so we assume first that. You are one, but the universe is full of diversity. It is made up of millions of forms. How is this mother? You are one, but there are many. I am one, formless, nameless. I choose to be many. Hence, I have to assume forms without which I cannot be many. You are eternal, but how is it that your forms are perishable? It is as it should be. When one is real, one must be unreal. Otherwise, why should we say it should be real? Real comes because there is an unreal thing. So form is born, remains for a time, and then dies. Birth, change, growth, dissolution, that is the nature of form. How can you exist, O Mother, when your forms perish? Just as, child, the gold remains even after the ornament is melted, during which process it loses its form, as also in the case of a lump of ice, which loses its form under heat, but the water of which it is made remains. Why did you wish to be many? We all would like to get the answer, no? But you know, the answer is also evasive. I desire to have a play. And the play cannot be unless there be more than one. Hence, I had to manifest myself as many. What do you gain by this play? Anandam, supreme bliss. How can you speak of bliss, O Mother, when the world is seen full of misery? Understand, my child, it is I myself acting as miserable, happy, angry, etc. Take that. Vinobhaji.
Talks.
The anger of the angry man, the love of the lover, the agony of the sufferer, the happiness of the happy one, the drowsiness of the idler, the activity of the industrious man, all these are manifestations of one and the same cosmic energy. Myself acting as miserable, happy, angry, etc. And Abhaji says, an artist paints a variety of pictures on the same type of canvas with the same brush. A sitarist creates different ragas out of the same seven notes. In literature, a variety of thoughts, ideas, feelings are expressed through the letters of the alphabet. Something on which you have to deeply think, you know. 26 letters or 27 letters? English, right?
26.
With 26 letters, we are changing the position and it gives us different meanings. It touches, it kindles different emotions. Simple, innocent letters, no? A to Z. Think about it. Highly enlightening. Deplorable, no? Same. Just imagine. Same A to Z, they have picked up some words. Anger. Nobody will say that anger. In sattvic mood, we will never say that. He's angry. Just imagine. Same thing. Anything that touches, changes our reactions, our mindset, all come from these 26 innocent A to Z tablets, alphabets. Start thinking now. An artist paints a variety of pictures on the same type of canvas with the same brush. A sitarist creates different ragas out of the same seven notes. Sarigamapadanina. In literature, a variety of thoughts, ideas and feelings are expressed through the letters of the alphabet. Same is the case with the creation. We find in it innumerable objects and propensities, but all of them are products of only two things, the eternal self and the eightfold Prakriti. water, fire, air, space, mind, reason, ego. These are the eightfold divisions of my nature. Just like from the 26 letters, you know, so many combinations give so many types of meanings. It kindles so many types of vibrations, so many types of reactions and responses. Similarly, here the Almighty Lord and Eightfold Prakriti. That means all the basic five elements, mind, intellect and the Ahankar. The sense of individuality. Sense of individuality, mind, intellect and the five elements put together, Prakriti. But all of them are products of the two things, the anger of the angry man, the love of the lover, the agony of the sufferer, the happiness of the happy one, the drowsiness of the idler, the activity of the industrious man. All these are manifestations of one and the same cosmic energy. These different emotions and urges, often contrary to each other, spring from the same source. As the cosmic energy within is one and the same is in all, the outer bodily cover of all is also the same in nature. The Lord is telling at the very outset that the self full of consciousness and the insentient Prakriti are the twin source from which all the creation has come into being. There are so many points for pondering, you know. It will help us, no doubt. Not hearing. Again we remind ourselves, this is a dialogue that has come up from within. And such type of dialogue to come from within, we pray. When we close, so many other dialogues come, you know. Not any of these fundamental questions. Because what happens is, when we sit and try for a dialogue, immediately the mind is taken out. Suddenly we realize we are trying to raise the question to the indwelling reality. Again we try, because of our preoccupation with the outer world is so much, it is difficult even to conceive of an inner dialogue. Forget about starting the dialogue. The fundamental question is that, how to train our mind to have this inner dialogue? Then the texture, quality of the thought. That means by Nama chanting, we must develop this witness consciousness to some extent, you know. And so the witness consciousness is put forward various questions by the chanter, the sense of individuality. So I think we can take it like this. Not that these are all a must, you know. This could be one of the dimensions. So when we keep on chanting Ramnam, we try to develop a witness consciousness, especially when we chant mentally. So then the chanting entity becomes aware of the witnessing entity. The chanting entity becomes aware of the witnessing entity and chanting stops. Again the thought goes out. Again we chant. So now we know, as we keep on trying this, the moment the witness consciousness is recognized, the chanting stops. and then the blankness. Mataji used to say that blankness is Papana, the blankness. But it won't stay there for long. It will be hardly for a fraction of a second. Again it goes out. So by trying this so many times in so many days, at least the first tangible gain is we become aware of the indwelling reality in the form of witness consciousness. Now the sense of individuality, instead of allowing the mind to go out, can develop to raise these type of questions. So it is keeping itself fully engaged, like that pole, you know, and the devil and the pole. The moment we don't allow, it will go out. Without our even knowing it, it will go out. So from that standpoint, we feel now that there is a need to know the question answer that is in that has cropped up in Papa, so that we know what happens when such a one is tried or initiated. So we have to keep on reminding, this is not a talk between A and B. It is purely a dialogue by the sense of individuality with the indwelling reality, whom he has mentioned as mother, because these are all activity, you know, creativity. Activity relates to mother, Purusha and Prakriti. Well, so how can you speak of bliss, O mother, when the world is seen full of misery? Understand, my child, it is I myself acting as miserable, happy and angry. That is why we remembered, angry, you know, anger of the angry man. How can you be acting as miserable and remain unaffected at the same time? Acting is always an appearance. It does not affect the actor. An actor pretends to be weeping, while all the time he remains internally at heart unmoved. So also with all other feelings and emotions. These are all highest, you know, very difficult to understand. Because when you develop an emotion, to feel that I am not affected, just imagine how to reach that stage. Shuddhi or Ashuddhi, you know? Shuddhi or Ashuddhi, when we discuss.
We have to become an actor, Swami. We have to become an actor.
If we have to become an actor, we should know the reality, you know? Then only the body, mind, intellect complex can become an actor. An actor is one who knows that he is acting, you know. He is different from the one that is acted. So what is the play of yours made of? It is made of three qualities, sattva, rajas, tamas. Harmony, activity, dullness. What is this play of yours made of? Sattva, rajas, tamas. By how is variety seen in the diversity? By countless modes of combination of these three qualities. These three gunas make together what is called Prakriti. That is why in Bhagavad Gita the other day we saw, you know, everything is split into three. Speech, thought, action, everything, food, giving, austerity or discipline, everything. In Bhagavad Gita, in 14th chapter, 17th chapter, 18th chapter, and some chapters are also there, where these things are explicitly discussed, exclusively discussed. Then I think we can even start now thinking to separate the other things. Other things, you know, when thought is divided, when word is divided, when action is divided, it covers everything, is it not? So what is sattva, what is rajas, what is in what way it is going to help us? There we think we have to take the 50-50 formula, prakritam and prayatnam. My nature, which is made up of these three, brings out these types of thoughts, brings out these types of words, brings out this type of deeds, and then my prayatnam, you have given me a freedom, 50%, by which I convert the tamas and rajas into sattvic, and then go beyond that. That is the tangible gain of this reading. Are we clear? Kindly think about it. When he says, all these are covered by countless modes of combination of these three qualities. How is variety seen? These three gunas make together what is called prakriti.
I mean, God also made three, creation, sustenance and essence, isn't it? Vishnu, Brahma, Shiva. Brahma should be creation, active. Vishnu should be sustenance, sattvam. Shiva should be tamasi, bodham, kidam. Maybe I don't understand, I'm putting my thoughts.
Anyway, we will.
They are governed by guna. It looks like that, Sabaji.
So our job is now to somehow understand the prakriti, the prakriti nature, the prakritam. That is all my thoughts, words, deeds are covered by these three. And the rajas and tamas, it is definitely pulling me away from the reality. Sattva is helping me to remember that. So we try with that, then we come to know intellectually through our spiritual preceptor or our shastras that we have to transcend the rajas and tamas to the sattva, and from there to go beyond that also. That means when I chant Ramnam, when I reach the mental state of silence, nothing is there. But if the chanting has to become sattvic, prayatna should be there. No? Just as Mataji the other day explained about bhajans, it applies to Ramnam also. We can say which is the sattvic Ramnam, which is rajasic Ramnam, which is tamasic Ramnam. Leaving no deep impress. But when we chant Ramnam in a sattvic way, it helps us to go beyond the sattvic way. That is called this silence. If I have to develop sattvic Ramnam, during my non-chanting time, I should be able to develop sattvic qualities. If the rajasic qualities predominate in me, my chanting also will be dominated by rajasic quality. along with that is tamasic, the dull, you know.
So Swami, what we chant morning, is it, I think it will be Rajasic Ayyadhik. Morning we are chanting Ramnam, 7 o'clock, you know, the flower offering. Is it Rajasic Swami? It looks like that, when I think of it.
We have some problem here.
We are active, you know. We have it very great passion. Thought of going like that.
There is a clear cut definition of speech. Mataji had explained this. I am unable to handle this because of the antivirus protection expired, so it is suspended now. So there it is elaborately mentioned.
Pranam chanting, yeah?
No, about bhajan she has mentioned.
Uh-huh.
She has mentioned. So we can apply the same thing to Ramnam, no? Now it leads, you know. Just now it just came up in our mind. When the inner mother says, these three gunas make together what is called prakriti. So it covers everything. So that means, you know, even including my Ramnam, it is three types. On some days you come and say, you know, today is Ramnam. First. That means Ramnam by itself is Satvik or beyond Satvik. But we, because of our dominance of Satvik, Rajasik and the Tamasic quality, we name it today, it was excellent. Today, you know, that was somehow, it was not there. The rhythm was not there, the tala was not there, something like that. So that means he can even now define which is Satvik Ramnam, which is Tamasik Ramnam, which is Rajasik Ramnam.
Sometimes Ramnam makes us to sleep. This is Tamasic
sleep. Correct, correct. Exactly.
This is making you to sleep.
We can take it that it leads to Tamas.
Tamasic.
Dal. If I am enjoying the sweetness, I will not sleep, you know. So now, having heard this much, we are trying to look at ourselves. Just like I should be careful in my speech, careful in my thoughts, careful in my actions, which will be directly reflected upon my chanting, because there is a direct attempt to reach him through chanting. We will come to that. This morning we read, you know, in the same text Papa says about the Ramnam. So Ramnam is the straight gate pass, you know, the straight visa to that. Okay. But if it has to become a visa, it has to be go beyond sattva. If it has to become go beyond sattva, first it has to become sattva. If it has to become sattva, we have to transcend the rajo and tamo attitude.
Depends upon the man who sings the song.
Definitely.
His mood, his way of...
Suppose at the time of chanting, at the time of leading, suppose you are reading or Gangadhar leading.
I am in Rajasic mood, I will be singing Ramnam in Rajasic mood, like that.
Then immediately, you know, so many concepts may arise. Even the witness consciousness can be there. You are hearing. Who is hearing? Again the mind goes out. Who is hearing? Like that we may try. Suppose, no, mind is still going out. Okay, travel with the sound. Put a fence with the sound. So that it is always within. And finally, who is now hearing? Stop. So if we are very clear that we are every now and then we are to have a taste of this, the witness consciousness, which is the final one. Utterance of God's name is to make the mind ultimately still free from all thoughts. If that is clear at the time of hearing or leading, then not only that it becomes sattvic, we are trying to go beyond the sattvic, you know. Just imagine, if these thoughts have to come at the time of chanting, the mind, it should become sattvic, you know. So now we know that Papa was able to do it because of the various disciplines, prayatna, he did. His pragritam got changed into sattvic. and because of that he was able to feel the witness consciousness. You have to see, this is the outcome of our internal churning, you know. When we keep on churning internally, we have to find out, are we moving towards the stillness? So morning when we go and hear, Om Shri Ram, Jai Ram, Jai Jai Ram, Om Shri Ram, Jai Ram, Jai Jai Ram, Om. One time. Shri Ram Jai Ram Jai Jai Ram Om Shri Ram Jai Ram Jai Jai Ram Om Shri Ram Jai Ram Jai Jai Ram Om Shri Ram Jai Ram Jai Jai Ram Shri Ram Jai Ram Jai Jai Ram Om Shri Ram Jai Ram Jai Jai Ram Om Shri Ram Jai Ram Jai Jai Ram Om Shri Ram Jai Ram Jai Ram See, in each tune, what does it, in what way it impacts us, you know? Are we moving toward this? Everything is beautiful. Everything is beautiful, nice. What is important is it leading us to stillness, to taste the stillness?
That means it depending upon the person who hears this.
Who chants and who hears?
I both. For example, yesterday morning, our Sri Krishna asked, how was this Thursday, Ram Nam? Maybe two, three, we are there in the room. One man told, super. I told, it is so-so. I told like that. And it is depending upon me. It has not appealed to me perhaps. Something like that. Or my mood, something like that. It depends upon the people who hear. As well as the people who chant. That also is there. One man told, super. I told you so. I thought so like that. He told you. I tell you. Just what happened today, yesterday morning.
Now the purpose of chanting is that he should be there. When he says clearly that these three gunas make together what is called prakriti, producing all actions, okay? That is why in Bhagavad Gita they have split everything into three. Everything into three. So that means we should know that Mataji had specifically mentioned about this bhajan. We stretch it to Ramana. That's all. There may be different words, but here it will be different, that's all. So now we should know how to make my Ram Naam Sattvik. Then I know that if I have to make my Ram Naam Sattvik, during the non-chanting time, all my thoughts, words and deeds should also be Sattvik.
That day you were reading this bhajan you were reading, no, some Sri Krishna Bhai.
Not this.
With the Divine Mother.
That was taken from Amma's, you know, Divine Mother. Which page I don't know, you know. This got stuck here, otherwise it would have. Anyway, that's all right. It's also a particular page, I don't remember. It is there, I have called out and separated, kept here. So it boils down to this. Good. Today's reading, you know, ultimately. Because we are all votaries of Ram now. We all derive, you know, our fuel, our incentive is Ram now. I don't know, which
she has
page.
Put a page number.
What happens when a man in Shuddha Sattva attends a Tamoguna Bhajan or a Rajoguna Bhajan?
Mila.
Would he get drawn to the external noise and clearance? Mataji, a person who is in a state of Shuddha Sattva, Shuddha Sattva, we are talking about.
Mahavishnu is supposed to be Shuddha Sattva.
Anyway, we will read this and then we'll go. He will never go anywhere near Tamasic or Rajasic Bhajan. He will be careful to avoid them. Not this. Previous. Okay. Mataji referred to the thrilling bhajan rendered by a party of visiting Italian devotees, a party of visiting Italian devotees last night, Peter group, concluding with the rendering of a biblical psalm in their own language. Mataji, Papa used to say that just as in everything else, in bhajan also three gunas were predominant and there were three kinds of bhajan. Papa in fact wanted me to go deep into every kind of bhajan that I came across and see for myself which guna dominated. Bhajan steeped in tamoguna means a lot of noise.
Like big shows.
Like big shows and processions where there is more thunder than devotion, more show than sincerity.
More sound.
Tamoguna stands for hitting, striking. And such bhajans are marked by banging of drums and the like. Bhajans are marked, Rajoguna bhajans are what you hear in temples and mutts. The Veda Goshas, mantras, the hymns recited during pujas. Sattvic bhajan on the other hand is the quiet, deep, peaceful, devotional singing which helps us to go within ourselves, which puts our minds at rest, makes us feel like imbibing of it more and more. There is one more bhajan of Shuddha Sattva, but that is internal bhajan and not one that you can hear outside. You are then lost in contemplation of Purushottam Papa and it is all stillness within you. Papa explained these things to me in such minutest detail because he was anxious that I should not miss anything. So suppose we stretch, you know, bhajan dhamna, then it becomes clear. So we need sattvic bhajan, quiet, deep, peaceful, devotional singing which helps us to go within ourselves, which puts our minds at rest, makes us feel like imbibing of it more and more. So that is the important, you know. So if we think we are not progressing, how to kandwa? Kurdoila. If we think we are not progressing with the help of Ramana, now I think Papa is giving us some clues. You can diagnose for yourself whether the Ramnam is chanted or the bhajan is rendered or your reading is rendered or your hearing is attempted on the sattvic plane. It is, if it is tamasic, if it is rajasic, then our we can know for ourselves. It is not staying with us. Whatever joy we had, it is not staying. When there were these round-the-clock Ramnam chanting during the important days, you know, we were all enthusiastically joining it, especially in early 90s when we started this Akhandana. On the important 7 days in a year, we used to have night throughout we all. At that time, to prevent our slipping into sleep, we used to have, you know, dynamic dynamic Ramanam chanting.
That is tamasic.
And now we understand it is tamasic. That is why the after morning, you know, 4 o'clock or 5 o'clock or 6 o'clock when the arati is over, we come back here. We get tired. Then the reason was we analysis was going on even then. We were even went to the extent of telling Swamiji whether this is going to help anybody, accepting the sentiment that we had attended. Swamiji simply smiled. It might not, depends upon the person. So we are not used to it, these night bhajans, you know. So once in a way we do that. And when once we do that, in order to prevent that the sleep does not overtake us, we used to have, you know, the speed will be more, accompaniments, the play of the accompaniments will be more vibrant. And especially during the last 10 minutes, you know, the speed will be, you know, 150 miles per hour. And the ganjara or whatever, it will be like this.
Yes.
At that time there is a thrill. And afterwards we get exhausted.
This is purely tamasic.
So from nothing we can say it is good. At that time, at least, instead of sleeping.
To avoid sleep,
that is the simple thing. To avoid sleep overpowering, we are. So now we know the.
We jump also, Sinha. We jump also, ding, ding. We sleep, we fall asleep.
Even the other day, when we were having a program like this, we were able to witness Ramnam chanting, when everybody is chanting. Now then, what happens then? Do we close our eyes and chant and concentrate? No. We look at everybody's face. Yeah. What is the purpose? If we start looking at everybody's place and then chant, the chanting does. Chanting is to take me to the stillness. Every time I should keep on hammering on my head. Finally, it should help me to get a glimpse of the stillness within me. Papa has made it very clear. Utterance of God's name is to make the mind ultimately still, free from all thoughts. It is in the stillness that you know and realize God. Am I moving toward that? Am I moving toward that? Somebody can take the fruition of life. There also in the he says about the mental chanting, you know. So morning when we mostly, you know, we try to hear. When we sit silently, we have to be conscious in the first place that the God we seek is in our own heart first. Then mentally repeat His name. Make the mind repeat the name until all its waves cease and it becomes perfectly still. Clear, no? There is no ambiguity here. Mentally repeat His name. Make the mind repeat the name until all its waves cease and it becomes perfectly still. If it does not easily become still, we have to continue the repetition of the name mentally with an attitude of self-surrender. Why are you making the mind to go? One part you are making the mind to chant, other part you know you are making, this is, please do. You are behind everything. So the moment we bring him into the picture, the wandering stops. Then he says, next step, we try to develop a witness consciousness. So this mental chanting should lead us to stillness. Stillness means we cannot explain, no? Immediately after we come out of the stillness, we know we had stillness. So who is now telling that we had the stillness? That is what is called witness consciousness. Consciousness is there. It has witnessed the silence. it is witnessing the chanting, it is witnessing the silence. So we try to develop a witness consciousness. This is a state of awareness of the immortal and radiant truth within us. Witness consciousness itself is, this is a state of awareness of the immortal and radiant truth within us. In fact, this awareness itself is God realization. So Papa is putting how with Ramnam. So if I have to reach this stage, during my non-chanting time, so many things have to take place. So it should become sattvic. A sattvic bhajan, a sattvic Ramnam chanting is a must. I should be very clear that Ramnam chanting should lead me to the stillness. Because stillness is something which will abide with us always. Ramnam chanting may come and go, but stillness is always there. Stillness is my original being. So when I take part or when I lead the Namajapa, if this is getting clarity, you know, if I become very, very clear why, what for I am chanting, so that every time when we chant, there will be an attempt on our part to get a glimpse of the stillness, the witness consciousness. And morning session is very interesting. When we start witnessing, hearing it, you know, we don't take part in the chanting. Each one has to devise some method.
The morning when we sit here, 6:30, 7 o'clock, that's a good time
for me. I think of all the chantings in this ashram, the silent chanting, in single chanting, solo chanting,
yes,
that is the sattvic chanting.
That is morning 5:30 to 6:30.
Mataji, why Mataji said that, now it is becoming clear to us. Where nobody joins, no accompaniments, excepting the harmonium probably, and slow tune, no?
Slowly.
Even if the mind goes out, it is alright. We are slowly trying the mind to put it on rails.
Yes.
Om Shri Ram Jai Ram. Jai Jai Ram Om. Shri Ram Jai Ram. Jai Jai Ram Om. I think this is the tune, no?
Same. Swamiji, nowadays, even the afternoon Ramanam also, some people, they start some 10 minutes, 15 minutes, the slow Ramanam only. For example, today was Sundar was singing, half an hour he was singing only slow Ramanam. Same raga. And the 15 minutes, last minute, you just fast. Like that.
It's okay.
Many of us, we do like that.
In a congregation.
Maybe this is automatically Papa has led us to sattvic Ramanam. I think so. Not planned. It has come like that. Nowadays I am fighting like that. I also think 15 minutes slowly.
Shri Ram Jai
Ram. Papa has made us sattvic Ramanam. It should have knowledge.
Jai Ram. Shri Ram Jai Ram. Jai Jai Ram Om.
श्री राम जय राम जय जय राम वो दिस समथिंग ऑन विच वी विल ऑल ट्राई टू पॉन्डर डीपली
बेस्ट लाइफ इट आई आल्सो फील
मेंटली रिपीट हिज नाम मेक द माइंड रिपीट द नेम until all its waves cease and it becomes perfectly still. If it does not become still, we have to continue the repetition of the name mentally with the attitude of self-surrender. We try to develop a witness consciousness. This is a state of awareness of the immortal and radiant truth within us. In fact, this awareness itself is God realization. Awareness. So Mataji had also clarified now, no? Through Mataji we got the clarity now. Papa used to say that just as in everything else, in bhajan also, just as in everything else, this aspect we should not forget. These three gunas, you know, pa. Thought, words and deeds. Three gunas were predominant and there were three kinds of bhajan. Just as in everything else, in bhajan also, in Ramnam also we can say, the three gunas were predominant and were the three kinds of Ramnam chanting. Papa in fact wanted me to go deep into every kind of bhajan that I came across and see for myself which guna dominated. Bhajan steeped in tamoguna means a lot of noise. Like big shows and processions where there is more thunder than devotion, more show than sincerity. Tamoguna stands for hitting, striking, and such bhajans are marked by banging of drums and the like. Bhajans are, Rajoguna bhajans are that you hear in the temples and mutts, the Veda Ghosh and the mantras or hymns recited during pujas. Sattvic bhajan, on the other hand, is the quiet, deep, peaceful, devotional singing which helps us to go within ourselves, which puts our minds at rest and makes us feel like imbibing of it more and more. So there also whether it makes puts our mind at rest.
We will feel calmness.
Calmness
we may feel by hearing the bhajan. A sort of peace. Peaceful sometimes we hear. That is sattvic. Bhajan is sattvic.
But if you are conscious of the bhajan, let us try, instead of every day we are chanting Ram Nam, either vocally or mentally, we can watch. We need not discourage or encourage anybody's chanting, because it may be a little faster, it may be a little louder, it's okay for him, no? That's why he is chanting it. And he will come back to the sattvic when the mind is trained. Suppose with this book knowledge, suppose we go and pass some comments. We will be wounding them, no?
Yes,
At least they are deriving some joy out of it.
Yes, sir. Correct.
So hearing this, let us not straightaway go and
keep it with ourselves.
No. When we do that, we will try to. This is applicable only for sadhagasas. So we will try to chant Ramnam in a sattvic way, with the idea that whether it should it is deep, whether it is peaceful, whether it helps us to go within ourselves. That means the within ourselves means the witness consciousness is being developed or not.